Finished with the max min stuff, so I'll remind you that last time we have some functions from R into R. I want to find the max and min, and that tells us that points for the gradient. The zero vector, right? So you are critical points. This is what we did last time. So those are our extrema. If we're over a finite range, then we have to look at the edges too. And if we have constraints, like some G. Well, let's just say from Rn to Rm, then we can either solve G equals zero for some of the variables and plug in, or use Lagrangian. Sometimes where you want to make a box with a square, you know, blah, 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 and you could do those kind of functions, and you just do this method. The Lagrange, and really what we're saying, I'll draw it in the variables, what this is saying, I have some function f, and then my constraints g maybe correspond to some other function g, and g equals a constant means I'm looking at a level set of this. And so either I solve and I get instead this curve and I try and maximize, that's supposed to be this. I try and find the highest point on this curve here. Or I can use Lagrange multipliers, which is telling me that I want to look at the gradient of f where the gradient of f and the gradient of g align, corresponds to looking at the level curves of g along f and finding the maximum that way. Right? They're sort of the same, but they're two different ways of looking at the same problem. Anyway, we did that. I'm putting it away. One other thing that, so in one variable, we have the question, say, when I want to find critical points of some function f, so here, maybe there's one here, that one doesn't look critical, so I guess it's not. Here, then we have a second derivative test. So we can find this where f prime is zero, and then either we can determine whether it's a max or a min by saying, well, at this point, everything's lower, or at this point, everything's higher, or at this point, it goes up and down. Right? This is sort of a first derivative test or just a local analysis. So one way to classify our critical points, let's call it x0, x1, x2 here. Either we look at, we look at, no better. F near one of these guys and decide whether it's going up or down, or we can use the second derivative test. Classify as to whether they're local mins or maxes. Let me remind you of the second derivative test. It says that if f prime of x naught is 0, then we have three possibilities, and f is nice. Then we have this case, f double prime of x naught is positive. This means it's a local min. We have this case, f double. Can you even see this? I can't see it anymore. Whoa. F double prime of x naught negative. This means we have a local max. And then you have f double prime of x naught equals 0, I did not. Right? People remember this from single variable calculus? No? Many people have never seen these little faces before? Yeah, they're little faces. See this guy? Yeah. He's a local min, and he's happy. This guy is a local max, and he's sad. This guy, he doesn't know what's going on. Okay, so anyway, this is how I remember the second derivative test, is by little faces. But, you know, you think about it. This is concave up, concave down. Can't really tell concave down. I mean, I suppose instead of drawing a squiggly thing, is this big? Okay, so I want to talk about an analog of the second derivative test for a function of several variables. So now, we have some function, some function f from Rn to R, and we have a critical point, so let's say this is continuously differentiable with a twice. So the derivatives are differentiable continuously, and I have a critical point let's say the gradient of f at some point x naught is the zero vector. So I have a critical point there. So I want to think about, you know, what is the analog of the second derivative test. And let me just draw it in two variables, but it works in higher variables. Well, the second derivative test looks at the concavity. And so if I have a local min, then I'm concave up no matter how I slice this thing open. So if I slice it anywhere, there's no color there, okay? So if I slice this bowl shape anywhere, in any direction or in every direction, then near x naught, I should see something that is concave up. And so in any direction u, so this is my direction u, then it should be concave up. So then if I have, so if the slice is concave up, then this should mean I have a min. And if the slice is concave down, then I should have a max. And if if it, so this is not just this slice, but all slices are. All slices are. And if the slice changes, so it's if some are concave up, some concave down, then I have a saddle. So that is, I have something that goes up this way and down this way, like here. If I slice it this way, I get something like that. But if I slice it this way, I get something like that, then I have a saddle. Right? So this is sort of second derivative test in many ways. But the thing to notice is that what we do is we slice the thing open and we look at all the possible ways of slicing. Now, this is in Rn, so maybe if I'm looking at a function of three variables, right, I have to slice it in all the various different directions that I can go. But every time I slice it, I'm really looking at f restricted to that direction. Okay? So now let's, is this clear? And if some slices go up and some slices go down, then we know we have a saddle type thing. If they all go up, then we know we have a minimum, and I guess I didn't draw this case. If they all go down, then we know we have a maximum. There's another situation where maybe somewhere it's flat, but then we just don't know. Right, so we have these three cases, and if some slices flat, then I don't know. Okay, yeah, you have a question.
Well, how do you slice it when you have more than three dimensions? Is your slice
so what do I mean by a slice?
Yeah. Now you see you have the other.
Right. I mean, this is just a. This is not. I mean, this is math, but this is not formal yet. This is not something you can actually do until you take this idea. Oh, and now we want to put it into practice. Right? But this is how you would think about the idea, and now you need to make the idea work. Right? So, back in taking a step back from the course, this is usually how people, how mathematicians think of math. You get some geometric idea in your head, or maybe not necessarily geometric, but you get some intuition about the problem. And now we codify this intuition into something that we can actually do.
So when you have a higher dimensional thing, then you can
mix. So
let's, you have different kinds of saddles, but like the other
Sure. So suppose I take something like x squared plus y squared minus z squared. This is my function f of x, y, z. Well, I can't draw a picture of it, because it's a function of three variables. The graph, if I'm going to draw it, lives in R4. But if I fix one of the variables, so for example, if I fix, well, so consider some of the slices here. So if I fix x and y, so let's just look at three slices. I'm going to look at the z function. So f of 0, 0, z looks like this, right? I mean, this is now a graph where this is z this way, and this is f this way, and this is actually the origin, but okay. F of 0, 0, z goes down. It's concave down. But f of x, 0, 0 is a parabola that looks like this. It's concave up. And similarly, f of y of 0, y 0 is also concave. So this is a saddle in some sense, in that it increases in some ways, but decreases in other ways. So there are directions that I can perturb from the origin that that make it bigger and other directions that make it smaller. So this is a saddle for a four-dimensional writer, right? Or if you want to think of one of the three dimensions as time, then you know this is a saddle, but the saddle's moving down and up and down. So you have an actual saddle that you're sitting on, but it's on a merry-go-round, so you're going anyway. Yeah. Okay, so it's just a generalization of the notion of saddle. So we'll call this a saddle because it increases in some ways and decreases in others. But this is exactly the idea. I could also slice it f of x, y, 0. X, 0. Where I'm going to move in x and y the same way. But that will be 2x squared, which again goes up like that. But I want to consider all of these variations all at once. We have some machinery to do this, but maybe you forgot what it is. So what am I doing? Let me restrict to two dimensions again so that I can draw. But it should work in three dimensions. So now, suppose I have my surface here. Well, let's just draw it here. Let's just make this bowl here. I have this bowl here sitting over this point, and I want to slice it open in this direction. That is, it's like the line, I don't know, x equals 2y or something. Right? So this is x, this is y, this is some direction. How can I codify this slicing open? Yeah, I consider a vector in this direction. I consider a unit vector u pointing this way. But we know how to take a directional derivative. We didn't just do that for the hell of it. It was a useful thing to do. Right? So here, we want to say, what happens? I'm going to move back down here in a second. What happens to f in the u direction? Well, if I cut it open in the u direction, then let's put u here. I get some picture that looks like that. Now that's a function of one variable. Right? This is f of t times u. I get something like that. That's a function of one variable. I can do one variable calculus. So I can just take the second derivative. I have the first derivative. There it is. Now I can take the second derivative. So we move back to there. Yeah. Sure. Okay. that's just slicing the thing open in the u direction. So now that's a single variable object. This is my u axis. I take t times u. Here's x0. I just do the thing. But I guess it's in the there. And so now I can do single variable calculus. So I can apply the regular second derivative test to this. So some arbitrary vector, let's call it hk. And here I'm assuming u is a unit vector, so h squared plus k squared is 1. But I don't really care about that so much. And now I just compute
h squared minus, no, no, no. 2xh k minus 6y k squared. Yes, that's right. 2y h squared plus 4x hk minus 6y k squared. So what is he saying? Well, now I can just read off all of the second derivatives in all of the directions. Right? If, for example, I want to move along parallel to the x-axis, then k is 0 and h is 1, and my derivative is 2y plus 4x, and so on. Again, remember hk lives here somewhere. Right, I'm just choosing a direction to move. So this is capturing how the function changes at every point x, y if I move in some combination of h and k. I've erased it already. To recast the second derivative test here, if for every combination, so now I have to be at a certain point in order to check it, right? I should really find the critical points of f before I do this game. But if every combination here gives me a positive number, then the thing is concave up and I have a minimum. If every combination gives me a negative number, then I'm concave down, I have a max. If some are positive and some are negative, then I have a saddle. And if lots of them are zero, then I don't. Okay? Does this make sense? All right, so let me finish this problem. I sort of got my cart ahead of my horse here. So let's find the critical points. So let's now have a problem. The reason I started with this is I just wanted to remind you how you would calculate the second partial directional derivative. The second directional derivative. There it is. Right? It depends on the vector in a quadratic way, but also on the point x, y. So let's change this problem, but really the same problem. Just phrase it this way. Find and classify all relative extrema for this function. X squared y minus y cubed minus y. So certainly the origin is one of them, but so what I did is I did the work to classify, but I didn't find them yet. Right? So to find them, so I'll have a relative extrema at the gradient is zero vector. Which is saying, well, the gradient is somewhere, here it is. So that's i.e. 2xy is 0, and x squared minus 3y squared minus 1 is 0. Those simultaneous. So I just want to solve those simultaneously. They're not linear, but they're not too hard to solve. So here, I certainly get critical points well, just looking I can see if x and y are no, not quite. I should have 0, 0. Why didn't I have 0, 0? Did I make a mistake? I thought I had 0, 0. But I guess I don't. Oh, no, I didn't have 0, 0. Right. Wait. Yeah, no, I don't have 0, 0. That was a different example that I decided not to do. So certainly they're not both 0. So if x is not 0, well, let's see if x is, well, okay. Either x is 0 or y is 0. Or maybe both. But both doesn't work. So I have either x equals 0 or y equals 0. But it won't be both, because if they're both 0, then negative 1 is 0, and that doesn't happen a lot. So I have not both. From this first equation, either x is 0 or y is 0. So now, if x is 0, then I have 3y squared plus 1 is 0. Okay, so I think in terms of the one that I did in my office, I transposed a plus and a y, so that doesn't happen much, right?
We wouldn't need that.
Okay.
Right.
Negative 3y squared minus y 1 is 0, so that means so y squared is 1 over 3 negative, which means that I have a complex root. Right, so there's no reals. So apparently I mistranscribed the problem because I think I needed a plus here in the original problem that I was doing, but okay. So there's no real solution. So we just have two extremes. The other case is if y is 0, then x squared minus 1 is 0. So x is plus or minus 1. So I just have two critical points to deal with. X is plus 1 and x is minus 1. So my critical points are 1, 0, and minus 1, 0. And now I need to decide whether they're maxes or mins or neither. And this is not the problem that I worked out before. So we'll see where it goes. So I think the problem that I worked out before had a plus here. But I don't want to change the problem. Why? Okay, so what about 1, 0? So at 1, 0, we have the second derivative form here. It's h squared, no, 0. All the y's are gone. So I just have 4hk. Second derivative is 4hk, right? Because y is 0, so I only look at the x term. And so this is sort of a stupid, well, it's a set. So this guy, since I can move around the circle, I could choose, wait a minute, this is 0. This is meaning it's 4x. Yeah, x is 1. 4xhk, x is 1, so that's 4hk. And unfortunately, this example isn't a good one because, well, sometimes, well, okay, so sometimes this is positive, sometimes it's negative. If h and k are the same sign, it's positive. If they're different signs, it's negative. So, some directions. So I have a set. And the other one is the same. So it was too bad that I made my mistake. Because the whole point of that example was to have something useful. So these are both sets.
Yeah.
it's just cool as hell.
You just have it on here.
Okay. So you make a graph of it, it's nice.
If you flip
But if I change one of the signs.
If you flip y cubes to a positive, it's got a min, max, and a zero point.
Yeah, right. That was the example that I meant, but not the example that I did.
Okay.
If you want, we can flip y cubed to a positive and get everything, which was what I meant, but not what I did. So if we change this to, so should I do it? The red pen seems to be gone. Okay, so I'll leave it to you. So if I look at, say, g of xy is x squared y plus y cubed minus y, then I get four critical points, and I have some of each. You want me to do that example? Are we okay with that?
We're good with this.
We're good with that? I don't need to beat this horse until it bleeds?
No.
It's already dead, so it doesn't matter. Okay. Let me... I guess I already wrote it out. It's sort of obvious. It's not written down, but let me write it down. So the second derivative test says, suppose you have f from Rn to R, twice differentiable, and you have a critical point at x0, then we have three possibilities. If the second partial with respect to u is always positive for all unit vectors u, then it's always positive, so we have a local min. If the second partial at x0 is negative for all unit vectors u, then we have a local max. And if the second partial is zero for some, is negative for some, positive for others, you have a set. Okay? So this is really, and then of course there's, well, if it's zero for a lot, then the test fails. Right? If it's just zero along one line, we're okay, but if it's always zero or something like that, then this is just nonsense. So this doesn't cover all possibilities. Right? We can have it's always positive and sometimes zero, and then no, because maybe it flattens out. Right? Everybody understands that? Yeah, sure, whatever. So for example, a function like, I don't know, if I change all of these, if I make that x to the 20th and y to the 4th there, then all of the partials are going to be 0, and there's nothing interesting going on. If I change, if I leave that as a y, then I'm flat in the x direction. I don't know quite what's going on there because I need to take 19 partials in order to figure something out. I don't want to do that. Okay? So, I want to
still have a little time. So
now, we can sort of specialize this. It's common, right? This theorem works R3, R10, whatever. You have 10 variables, you have 2 variables, whatever. But we can specialize it to the functions, say R2 to R. And then we get something a little more calculable. So if we take, we have a function from R2 to R, that is, I have f of x, y, z, then I don't have as many partials to deal with. Right? The gradient only has 2 entries, like in this case, rather than the gradient having 3 or more. And so I really only have, so if this guy is twice continuously differentiable to the critical point at some point x naught, y naught, then, well, I can just calculate the second partial. And I have, if you remember, I just have the partial, the 2 partials with respect to x, I have the mixed partial, and I have the 2 partials with respect to y. And these are equal, because the function is continuously differentiable. So that means that the mixed partials are equal because the function is nice-ish. And so this is just since I get 2 of those, that's the second derivative. Right? I just take all of the partials and I dot it with my u. And so those are just my partials there. I missed something. But yeah, I need my u. I'm sorry. I left off when I'm talking. Sorry. Let me try this again. So my gradient vector is going to be fxx at my point. And I'm going to get a u from that. I called it h and k, so I'm going to get an h squared term out of that. Then I will get fxy, and I'll get an hk term here. So this is from the second partial in the x's and the y's. And then I'll get another one of these with a mixed, and then I will get the last one in the k-squared direction. Right, so that's what the second partial of f is always going to be. Something like that. And so now, we can sort of narrow down what we do to look at this. So we can write a second derivative test just for degree 2, so in this case, and I'll explain why in a second, you look at the discriminant, which is the product of the xx and the xy, and you subtract off the square. So fxx, I'm going to leave off the times fyy minus the product of the mixed partials . So I look at that number. Yep.
How did you get that?
I'll explain in a second. It's from, if you solve a quadratic equation, this is b squared minus 4ac. There's b squared, and there's 4ac. I'll write it in just a second. So I look at that. So this is just some number. It's not a derivative. It's discriminant. Let's call it delta. Okay, so I look at that, and then I have some possibilities. So if delta is positive, and
either one of these things is positive. Fxx is bigger than 0, or Fyy is bigger than 0. Then I have a min. If the discriminant is positive, and both are negative, right? That, I just want to make sure I didn't do something wrong. No, either is negative. Yeah. How can that be either?
What the F?
I think for
yeah, I know. They're not disjoint cases, so something's screwy there. I'm going to assume that they're both negative. I think they're both negative. We'll check it when we do the proof. So, we got to check these conditions. So if both are negative, then I have a max. And then another case is if the discriminant is negative, I have a set. And the discriminant is 0 out of two. Okay? If the discriminant is 0, then you can't do this. So let's, since something is wrong with what is written in the book, let's figure out what's right. So the book says or here. And I don't remember, so I have to check it. Yeah.
The both are negative or both are positive, they are the same thing. If they both are negative. Or if they both are positive, they are the same thing.
What do you mean the same thing?
Do you apply the or to the first, the minimum one, and then you can apply the amount?
You might mean that they're product. Either way, their product comes out.
Well, if their product comes out negative, okay. This has to be and, right?
Yeah. It's an and.
Because if one of them's negative and one of them's positive, then the discriminant is negative.
Yeah, the book says not
it has to be and. So either, right. Either means check either one. If it's positive, you're cool. Right? Because if this one's positive and the discriminant is positive, it's positive, done.
Wait, are you finding this?
Right? Because if this one's negative and the discriminant's positive, okay, then you have some rather interesting arithmetic that you add a negative number, and somehow you get a positive number. I do that a lot, but something's wrong there. And here, if they're both negative, which means you can check either one. Okay. Yes. Okay. So, he's right. But he's right in a weird way. If either one of them is positive, you're fine. If either one of them is negative, you're fine. Because the other one is also negative for free. As long as the discriminant is positive. So these guys have to, so let's try it this way. Delta bigger than 0 means fxx and fyy have the same sign. And so this can be an or, because or means and. You only have to check one of them because they have the same sum. Okay, so let's... So just check. Yeah, let's go. Okay.
could just erase one of these conditions, but it doesn't matter, because one you get for free. Okay, so let's think about how the proof of this is going to go. So if I look at this here, well, so, because otherwise it just looks like it fell out of the sky. So the proof actually explains where this came from. So if I look at that quantity, I know that since my unit vector is a unit vector, I don't have h equals 0 and k equals 0 at the same time. One of them has to be non-zero. So I can, right, this picture, one of them has to be non-zero. So I can pick one of them. So let's look at this quantity, and let's factor out, I don't know, let's say h. So if h is non-zero, then I have h squared, so my second partial is h squared fxx, I'm going to stop writing the of, plus 2 fxy of k over h, not of, that's times, plus fyy times, I'm pulling out k over h quantity squared. This is a polynomial in k over h. Right? H squared isn't zero, so it doesn't affect. And now I'm left with this polynomial in k over h. And my question is, what I need to know is this always positive, or is it always negative? Or does it sometimes change sign? Right? I have a possibility, if I think of, these are numbers, right? So I have a plus 2b, let's call it z, plus, let's call this c. Let's call this b. Let's call this az squared, where z is k over h. And either this thing looks like up here, oops. I have three possibilities. Either this thing is up here somewhere, or it's down here somewhere, or it crosses. I have three cases. Either this has a real root, or it doesn't. Well, so we just use the quadratic formula. So if this doesn't have a real root, so the roots here, so the roots, let's write it this way, fxx plus 2fxy, let me just call it z, plus fyy, z squared equals 0. The solutions to this are from the, you know, you apply the quadratic formula. Negative 2 fxy plus or minus the square root of 4 fxy quantity squared minus 4 times this product over 2. Those are my solutions. Again, remember, these things are numbers. We calculate them, they're numbers. So those are the roots of this equation. And I don't want to have any. So that means, I won't have any if fxy squared minus fxx fyy is negative. Well, that's negative d. This is d. The delta, So, if delta is positive, then I don't have any roots to this equation. And we just need to check whether for any one value of z, like z equals 0, the thing is positive or the thing is negative. So, if this thing's positive, well, this thing's positive too. So it's always positive, so we're cool. So that's this condition right here. If, on the other hand, fxx is negative, then it's always negative, and this guy is negative, so we're below, and again, we don't have a root, so okay. And if this number delta is not positive, well, then it's negative, which means that I have two solutions to this equation of h over k over h, which means it changes sign, which means I have a sign. So the only case that's a problem for me is if this discriminant here is completely zero. For lots of things. So then we're okay. So, quadratic. Alright, so I didn't write out all the words. And you also have to deal with the case where maybe h is 0. Then just change all the h's for k's and k's for h's. Then we're okay too. Alright? Is that good enough to convince you that this proof is okay? And that's where this funny condition comes from. We look at the difference between the product of the second derivative in x, second derivative in y, and the mixed derivative. And if this is a lot bigger than that, then we have either a max or a min, depending on who's positive. Okay. Did that. Okay. Any questions about this?
Isn't, like, if you wrote the partials in the matrix, wouldn't that determinant be the same thing?
Yes, the determinant of the Jacobian matrix, the Hessian, the derivative of the derivative. It's the same thing. It's the determinant of that partials matrix. It's the same thing, right? Because, well, there it is, right? I have xx. The matrix he's talking about is this one. Take its determinant, you get that. It's exactly the same question. Because what is it when we're computing the second directional derivative, we're just taking this and we're dotting it with hk. Or h. Okay, so I'm going to stop with Matt's main kind of problems.
Wait, I have a question.
Yeah.
Did we check for the case that h is equal to 0?
So if h is 0, use k. So if I use k and I factor out k squared, my equation will be k squared fxx k. Who's on top here? H over k.
Also, the model's both of them. So your equation is equally valid either of them.
Because they just trade roles.
Oh, that's very cool.
Okay. Right? So because this is symmetric, just trades roles. So it's okay. So, yeah. I mean, yes, you're right. I do have to check k equals 0, but once you write it down, you see it's the same condition, so we're fine. Other questions? Okay. So, and now we'll put aside the question of max min kind of things. Let me remind you that a week from, no, 2 weeks from Wednesday, we have a test, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
But I won't be here.
You guys have fun.
Not next Wednesday.
It's not next Wednesday? No. We have class next Wednesday. Wait. Yes.
Oh,
right. Yeah. It's still a ways away.
Okay.
It's not immediate. It's still a ways away.
Woo.
Right? We still have three more classes with me.
Okay.
One class with Artem, and then a class.
Okay.
Artem is actually his name.
Okay.
We call him Dr. Google.
Oh. It's an actual Artem.
That's his actual name.
All right.
It's not a made up name. So let's move on. Now I'm burning up all the time. I'm really planning to do more. Okay, so another thing that I need to mention, that is worth mentioning at this point, we will come back to it, really kind of logically belong earlier, but okay, is other coordinate systems. And these come up in several applications, so let me remind you, you should be relatively familiar with x, y. In plane, this is for R2. We have this one, but then we also have polar coordinates, r and theta, right? So here, x is r cosine theta, y is r sine theta. So this is convenient for describing some class of curves. We have several analogs of polar coordinates in R3. Right. So in R3, we have sort of two common analogs of polar coordinates. We have cylindrical coordinates. So here's my XYZ land. And I can do polar coordinates in XY. So say I want to describe this point. Sits there. I could do polar coordinates here. I want to describe that point so I can think of it this way. So this is R here, and then Z is just the height. Right? So cylindrical coordinates, I specify an angle theta and a distance in the xy plane r. Let's just write this down. Theta is the angle with the x-axis. Well, it's really the xz plane. That is the plane y equals 0. R is the distance from the z-axis, and z is just z. Okay, so this is one way that we can describe things in cylindrical coordinates. It's just polar coordinates in the xy plane, and then we move them up and down. And it's called cylindrical coordinates because if we fix the radius and let theta and z vary, yeah.
R theta comma z.
Yeah, I don't know that they're okay. Pick an order. I mean, just like, you know, if I write 2, 4 in polar coordinates, what does that mean? I have no clue which is theta and which is r. So usually in polar coordinates, I would write R equals 2, theta equals 4, and now I know what it is. So similarly here, I don't know who comes first.
So you just
pick one.
And sometimes we
so sometimes people use one, sometimes people use last, but we're really thinking here, so let's just write the relationship. Right?
Like we have to like parameterize and like use the four. All right, close to something.
Well, maybe it's not a curve. Maybe it's a surface. All right. So here, right, x is r cosine theta, y is r sine theta, and z, well, it's just
normal.
So that's our relationship. If you want to solve for theta in terms of, you know, we can write arc tan as long as you choose the right branch, right? Theta is the inverse tangent of y over x, but you got to choose the right one. And z is still just z. And r is x squared plus y squared. Right, we can go back, but okay. But this is good for describing things which sort of naturally, so as an example of this, a helix is very easy in these coordinates. We just, so in cylindrical coordinates, would just be some curve like r is fixed, and theta is t, and z is t. So that's an easy parameterization of a helix, because here in cylindrical coordinates, I'm over the circle, r is 1. I start off with theta, when t is 0, I'm here, and then I just move up like that with units feet. It's much cleaner or easier than the other way. So in some sense, this is a natural generalization of polar coordinates. And certain curves are maybe easier in terms of cylindrical coordinates. Another variation is that, you know, you can go full polar. Maybe, please move this one. Is I can do spherical coordinates. So spherical coordinates are also quite useful. Especially if you're doing something like, I don't know, astronomy or something like that, where you think of the Earth at the origin, and then we're describing something flying around relative to the Earth, then maybe spherical coordinates are our friend. So here, once again, I'm going to draw the same picture. I have my point here, there, but as in x and y, I'm going to take this, so I have this angle theta, and which is my distance to the x-axis, but instead of going up a height z, I'm going to think of a triangle sitting here. And for some reason that I don't really understand, people usually measure this angle instead of this angle. You can choose either one. This is usually called phi. So I have theta is the angle with the x-axis, and phi is the angle from the vertical. Angle from the z-axis rather than the angle from the xy plane. And then, I don't know, sometimes we call this rho. Let's call it rho. Rho is the distance to the origin. Okay? So this gives us another way, and you know, and here's our r that we're not using. Some people call rho r. You know, these labels, right, this is a green bar, bro. Looks like a bird. And so, you know, an easy, so in these coordinates, so I guess also, maybe in cylindrical, well, let's do this one. A sphere is really easy to describe here. R equals constant. There, there's a sphere.
Nice.
Right? It's just everything distance one from the origin. There's a sphere. And I can let theta and b vary as they need to. I mean, usually, you know, you restrict these guys to be, say, between 0, 0, and pi, and this guy to be, so typically, let me erase the plot picture. Typically here we would take phi between 0 and pi, and theta between 0 and 2 pi, but you don't have to. That sweeps out everything. And we typically take, but don't have to, rho positive. And similarly here, you typically take theta between 0 and 2 pi, and z is 0, it is an r is positive, but you don't have to. Right? If you allow rho to be negative, just like in polar coordinates, if you allow r to be negative, you have multiple representations of the same point. One thing to notice is one sort of bad thing in this coordinate system is the origin is represented with lots of things, right? Once rho is zero, I have no good definition for theta and phi. I have a singularity in this coordinate system at the origin. There's a problem there. And there are other sets of coordinate systems that are useful in, let me just mention them, that are useful in various applications, like you might have toroidal coordinate systems. This one's not mentioned in the book, but what the heck. I'm going to specify some distance from the origin, and then I'm going to specify some angle along that. But then rather than growing like a sphere, I might specify something from that circle. So that would give me a different set of coordinates, right? I might fix radius equals 1 or something useful. I might just fix my radius to be 1, and then I'll take a torus, donut. So I might describe my place here by saying what angle I take out, go out to that circle of radius 1, say how far out the circle is, and go around. This is useful in different contexts. This one, I mean, it's not even mentioned in the book, but you know, there are different collections of coordinate systems depending on what is natural for you, what you're trying to describe. So let's try and think about what do these things, I don't have any time, okay. So in order to be a good coordinate system, what do we have to have? What is the, in order to describe a patch of R3 in a nice way, really, in all of these cases, I'm describing the transformation from x, y, z to, I don't know, rho, theta, phi space. I have some function here, let's call it t. From however many variables I have in Cartesian coordinates to however many variables I have in my target coordinate systems. And in order to be a good coordinate system, I need to be able to go both ways. So that means that the derivative matrix of T, which is called the Jacobian, needs to be invertible. So to be good, this transformation, dt, invertible. In this case, it's a 3x3 matrix, and it has to be invertible every place I care about the coordinate system. So it can be nasty far away, but I have to be able to take the inverse. I have to have a nice transformation from one to the other. This is why this is brought up here in this book, because we want to be able to go backwards. We talked about the inverse function theorem. We have an inverse function theorem exactly when our transformation has an inverse. The derivative matrix is invertible. So here, these guys have a problem with zero. Stay away from zero, it's okay. So as long as we stay away from zero, then these are perfectly good coordinate changes. But near zero, stuff gets crunched up, or weird stuff happens, so we like to stay a little bit away from zero. These coordinate systems are not so good at zero. And that's sort of evidenced by the fact that I have multiple representations for zero. This coordinate change, where's the spherical coordinate change? I didn't even write it down. Oh well, you can figure it out. It's r cosine theta, r cosine, it's rho cosine theta, cosine maybe sine b. Anyways, you can look at the picture and figure them out. But there's a problem when r is zero. Yeah.
I thought the spherical coordinate system was defined as a function of like r theta and b, not rho theta.
Do you want to call rho r? Okay.
No. I mean, like, it's defined as.
Jim's over here. You already used him.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
So
for spherical, we want to know how far away you are from the origin. Some people call this r. Some people call this rho. I called it rho to distinguish it from the radius in spherical.
Yeah.
I think the book maybe even calls it r. My calculus book when I was your age, back when there were dinosaurs, called Rho. So the whole point of this is really that we want to make sure that when we care, the derivative is not zero. I will talk about integration next.